How tough is too tough when it comes to sports and brain injuries? It's an issue we've followed over a number of years. Today, there was new data to chew on.
Week after week, the big hits keep attracting big TV audiences to professional and college football. But concerns over head injuries in football and other sports have also continued. About a connection between repeated blows and a degenerative brain disease known as chronic traumatic encephalopathy, or CTE. The latest evidence comes from a new report from Boston University that's been published in the scientific journal Brain. The four-year study examined brain autopsies of 85 male donors ranging from age 17 to 98. It included football players at various levels, boxers, hockey players, and a group of veterans. It found evidence of CTE in 68 cases, almost all of them athletes. The football players included linemen, running backs, and tight ends who'd received repeated hits throughout their careers. One was the late John Mackey, profiled with his wife Sylvia in 2009 by Ray Suarez.
In the good days, how is it different from what we're seeing now from Mr. Mackey?
He'll get up and walk up and down. He'll throw and catch the ball. Actually, today would be a good day if it weren't for the myoclonus twitching. They call it myoclonus jerks.
Mm. And speech?
He doesn't talk anymore, very rarely.
Mackey passed away in July of last year. Others in the study who showed signs of CTE were Derek Bogard, a former hockey enforcer who died of an accidental overdose in May of last year, and former NFL safety Dave Duerson, who took his own life in February of 2011 after complaining of headaches and a deteriorating memory. The NFL faces a class action lawsuit filed last July by thousands of former NFL players and their families, citing lack of disclosure about potential dangers.
For more, we're joined by one of the lead researchers, Dr. Ann McKee, a neurologist and co-director of the Center for the Study of Traumatic Encephalopathy at Boston University, and Mark Fainaru-Wada, an investigative reporter with ESPN, who's working on a documentary about this subject for Frontline. Well, Ann McKee, let me start with you. What do you see as the key finding from this study that perhaps we didn't know before?
Well, this study, this disease, chronic traumatic encephalopathy, has been around since the 1920s, but there have really only been a smattering of reports. In this paper, we more than double the world's experience with this disorder and take it from the very beginnings, where it first affects the nervous system, where it affects the nervous system, and then we see it expand progressively in older and older individuals until it really is a destructive disease that affects most of the brain.
And just to be clear here, the focus is less on the, the major hits or major concussions and more on sort of repetition over time?
Right. This is exposure to what we call mild traumatic brain injury, usually considered almost insignificant hits. They don't even have to rise to the level of concussion. They can be subconcussion. But when you're exposed to these hits over a very long period of time, usually many years, you can set yourself up for some long-term consequences.
All right, Mark Fainaru-Wada, you've been reporting on some of the, there was pushback from some of the experts to these findings. Tell us what you've been hearing from them and from the NFL, for example.
Right. Well, my brother and colleague Steve Fainaru and I have been reporting on this for a while, both for a book and a documentary and for ESPN. And, as Dr. McKee stated, the findings on this are substantial in terms of the numbers. They're the largest number ever reported. And what we did find, though, was there's a lot of pushback in the scientific community. Dr. McKee told us about her recent experience at a conference in Zurich where there were various folks who criticized the work. We talked to some of those people, including some NFL doctors who were there. One NFL member of their brain committee said, relating these cases, creating a causal link based on these case studies to football is akin to saying basically all the ankle injuries suffered by football players wearing Nike shoes were because of the shoes. The argument there is that, and as Dr. McKee has acknowledged, the data set they're working from is skewed because it's based on a series of brains from athletes and players who were showing signs before death in large cases of having mental issues. And so the question that everybody is trying to figure out is, what is the actual incidence of this disease? in looking at brains that were healthy versus players who actually were exposed to football.
Well, let me ask you, Dr. McKee, to comment on that. How definitive is this? What else do you need to look at to know, especially things like how to treat people?
Well, this study is definitive in describing and defining what the disease is and how it affects the nervous system. But a key question remains, what's the incidence and prevalence? How common is this disorder? And that we will never establish from an autopsy study. For that, we really need to be able to identify this disease in living individuals, and that's a huge focus of our more recent research. How can we identify this in people that are living? And that might be through MRI scans or PET scans, that especially the ones that might tag the tau protein that develops. It might be through blood tests or tests of your urine or your CSF. But we're really going to need those tests to be able to determine if a living person has this disease, and then be able to measure that person's exposure to head trauma. And that will be the defining moment. And that'll probably take a longitudinal prospective study involving probably thousands of subjects.
Well, so Mark Fainaru-Wada, how are professional leagues, people that work with students, student athletes, how are they taking this? How should parents take this in terms of, the stakes here, the implications for when people should be in contact sports?
Well, I think the numbers are what strike most people, and I think those are the questions that raise issues for some of the leagues and how they deal with it and how significant this is. The study talks about out of 34 NFL players studied, 33 of them ended up having CTE, and so I think that's obviously creates questions. Some people have suggested that the numbers raise more alarming questions than are real. But the league, for its part, the NFL, which faces the most scrutiny on this issue with, as your piece noted, 4,000 former players suing the league right now, the league has looked at, they've changed rules to address the issue of these sort of larger hits that we've seen, these sort of defining hits. I think the larger question, though, as Dr. McKee touched on earlier, is the subconcussive blows. There's increasing research around that. 40% of the cases of CTE they identified in NFL players were linemen. And so that raises questions about is just the definitive the nature of repetitive hits in the game something that exposes a player? And I think that's what the leagues and parents are trying to figure out as they try to find out how significant an issue is this and what the risk is for their kids.
Well, Dr. McKee, how far would you go at this point in terms of what you say to parents or athletic directors or professional teams about taking the findings and using them somehow?
Well, I think the major caution I would have is that all parents, coaches should take every head injury seriously and try to eliminate the minor hits or the hits to the head as much as possible in any sport. We've already seen in the last 4 or 5 years a tremendous focus on concussion. It used to be considered a fairly trivial injury that no one needed to sit out for, and now we're taking it seriously and we're resting those athletes and making sure they're completely asymptomatic until they return to play. And I think this has been a tremendous development, and it will probably go a long way in terms of preventing the development of these long-term consequences in these individuals. At this point, we don't have any evidence, there's no available evidence that a single isolated or a few isolated concussions that are well managed, that means well rested, the individual is asymptomatic before he goes back to play, there's no evidence that those injuries lead to this disease. The injuries that seem to lead to this disease are years and years of exposure to many hits, and those hits may be relatively mild.
And Mark, let me just ask you very briefly, you mentioned that lawsuit. Just tell us briefly, where do things stand? That goes on, right?
Yes, it's ongoing. I mean, the current state is that both sides are arguing. The NFL has argued for dismissal of the case. It's before a federal judge in Philadelphia. I think both sides expect some ruling on whether the case will get tossed out or not in the spring. And surely there'll be an appeal, one would expect either way. So I think one expects the lawsuits are going to drag on well into next year at least.
Mark Fainaru-Wada and Dr. Ann McKee, thank you both very much.
Thank you.